Everyone has to follow their own path in life. The path most people prefer is safe and common. Only the chosen few would venture down a path of their own. They would prefer a journey to the unknown, facing danger, seeking great adventures, and pursuing their wildest dreams. The dreams that make life worth living. The dreams worth waking up for every morning. The dreams that give you strength and energy to do the impossible. Some may think their extreme courage is madness. Let them think as they wish. It is the way of brave hearts that live as legends. Alex is one of our dreamers. His life story, full of sudden twists and amazing adventures, started in Russia. He had dedicated his life to learning martial arts and had been traveling around the world for many years. His quest for mastery brought him to a wise teacher, who told him a mysterious legend about a king's blade. His world had completely changed after that. Is this mystery known to anyone other than Alex?
My name is Felix Cortes. I was born in Puerto Rico. As a young man, I moved to the US and I lived in Queens, New York. That's where I started my journey in training in Filipino martial arts and other various arts. I'm here in the Philippines in research of the history of the arts and also looking and researching for the King's Blade.
Once upon a time, a great galleon cast anchor in a beautiful harbor of one of the countless little islands scattered in the ocean. Those who landed were clad in iron armor and set out to enslave a free and peaceful tribe that lived on the island. They had mighty weapons, but the tribal leader didn't want to submit to foreign power. He turned to the elders of his tribe for advice. To protect his people, they entrusted him with an ancient relic of their ancestors, a blade of unsurpassed power. Its power was that of Mother Earth itself. Its fury was that of 1,000 warriors. Its wisdom was that of great tribal leaders. My brethren, we are to weather a great storm. Cruel foes have invaded our islands. They're burning down our villages and slaughtering our cattle. Iron-clad outsiders think they are masters of our land, and nobody would dare to face them. But we have the power to strike back. Our glorious ancestors gave us their weapons and strength to overcome the enemy. My brethren, will you follow me? For the sake of our land, for the sake of our home, let us either win or die in glory. And the great battle started. The skies grew dark, the land shook beneath the feet of the warriors, and the tidal waves turned red with blood. Perilous and indomitable were the warriors of the little tribe. The outsiders fled in horror. During the last furious onslaught, the invaders and their famous leader were destroyed by the islanders. A mighty shout of triumph rang over the harbor. The leader of the tribe raised the bloody blade that won back liberty to his people. For many long years, the blade passed from one chief to another until it was lost in one of the many great battles. The legend foretells the hero who will find the king's blade will obtain the might of invincible warriors and the wisdom of great leaders. King's Blade. Is it reality or myth? The quest for the blade starts now. Our story begins in the capital of the Philippines, Manila. Is a huge metropolis. Its streets are teeming life day and night. Rich, luxurious districts are found side by side with less fortunate communities. Rich or poor, the people who live there are affable and open-hearted. They live in the present, welcome every new day, and value things they have. There are many famous grandmasters of the Filipino martial arts in the city who graciously impart their knowledge to the next generations. hoping to find any information about the King's Blade, Felix strolls into Lanata Park. This is the place where the best teachers of traditional fighting styles have been gathering together and instructing disciples for many years. Arnis, Kali, or Eskrima are the time-proven combat systems based on ancient traditions and effective self-defense techniques of modern times. The martial artists of these systems use swords, sticks, knives, and other types of bladed weapons for many forms of combat. To his surprise, Felix runs into his old pal, Ray Dionaldo, the training partner of his youth in the United States. After sharing some warm memories, Ray gladly introduces Felix to the council of esteemed grandmasters. Such great luck, thinks Felix. Here I can probably learn more about the fate of the King's Blade. On the strength of one of his instructors' reference, Alex arranges a meeting with one of the most renowned researchers of the Filipino martial arts, Grandmaster Romeo Macapagal. The old Spanish fortress of the Intramuros district in the Manila Historic Center seemed to be an ideal place for meeting and talking about the roots and traditions of the Filipino combat styles. This is a rare opportunity, and the conversation might be a turning point for the search.
Filipino martial arts is from an indigenous fighting system using short blades, sometimes the long kampilan, and Filipinos were very used to using these blades because they used them for farming work and also for fighting when necessary. The system originally consisted of silat-like movements and the local flavor from here, because silat is far way down in the south, in Malaysia and Indonesia. But then we were occupied at two times by the Sri Vijayan and the Majapahit Empire. And then the Chinese always traded here. So somehow the Chinese way of fighting also gave a little influence into the Filipino martial arts. But you will note that on the coast, there will be many identifiable influences. But as you go inland into the mountains, there are less and less and more real indigenous Filipino methods. Very low on the ground, crouching, and always covering the head and cutting at the legs, because the ground is slippery. Okay, so they need to be very stable on their feet. To say that where the Spaniards were able to establish towns and large settlements, the sword play was very heavily influenced by the Spaniards. Because it was to the interest of the Spaniards to teach the local people on the seashore how to fight off the slave raiders. And therefore, their only knowledge is their own swordsmanship. That's what they brought to the Indies. This is another way. I thrust to him, he parries this, and when he parries that, my cut comes in, and around, and another thrust. Here, if he's on guard, I strike his guard and strike at the arm. See? But never crossed. When the other hand comes, see? Pa! Pa! But FMA is distinctly very agile, very fast, very athletic, and Filipinos are very, flexible. Okay. And coupled with formal techniques from Europe and Spain.
Tagaytay, a city in the Cavite province. It is one of the most picturesque towns with unique mountain scenery. The breathtaking volcano and Lake Taal reside nearby. It is impossible not to recognize this little house on the hill. The architecture is strikingly different from the neighboring houses. Yes, I found the home of Grandmaster Rene Tongson, Felix thinks. Grandmaster Rene Tongson is the caretaker of the unique classical style of Benica Tres Pontes.
Hello, my name is Felix Cortes, and I just arrived from the USA. May I see Grandmaster Rene Tongson?
Yes, please follow me. Pa, may bisita ka.
Hello, Grandmaster Rene Tongson. My name is Felix Cortes. It's a pleasure to meet you. Mano po.
This is a nice farm you have here.
Oh, yes, yes.
Yeah, I see you have a lot of fighters.
This is one of my hobbies when I'm doing even my free time. Yes, and This is one prize fighter. He's fighting again in 10 days.
Yes,
very tough chicken.
Good looking. I like the color one over there, black and white.
Yes.
Yeah. It's good looking.
So, how can I help you?
Well, I heard that you're the caretaker for Abanicos Tres Puntas.
Yes.
And I wanted to hear more about the history, you know, and that's why I'm here. Yes, sir.
Yes. Oh, yes. My privilege and our honor. You see, Abanicos Tres Puntas is an old system, Filipino fighting system.
Opa.
That's why you call it classical Arnis Abanico Tres Puntas. It's not for sports, it's actually for fighting. It's been tested for many generations, fighting in wars, one battle to another. It's Abanico Tres Puntas is the system, and it has four subsystems. Subsystems on combat sticks.
Yes.
And Dumuk Ipil. And subsystem on blades. And mano-mano.
And mano-mano, okay.
Felix is glad to hear familiar words in Spanish.
It was founded by the great grandmaster Mateo D. Stelioso of Antique province in the central part of the Philippines.
May I ask, how was the training in the early days?
I would say there's a lot of difference now. Long before we just like me, I started using sugarcane instead of the traditional or the most common that you see, the rattan stick. Slowly I was learning under my senior instructors in Hinigaran. Negros Occidental. It's in the central part of the Philippines, and I would remember I started sometime summer of 1966. Yes, so I would say it's about 51 years now.
Yes, so you're a high-level senior grandmaster.
Some people said we are.
I would say you are.
Yeah. But you see, every day it's a learning process. We don't stop learning.
Yes,
we must,
sir,
continue learning.
Yes,
just,
sir,
like the old days when we started, when I was a young boy, we would train every day.
Meanwhile, Alex wastes no time. Grandmaster Romeo Macapagal shares his knowledge of the history of Filipino martial arts. It's time for Alex to learn about the mysterious Moro warriors, southern tribes of the Philippines well known as experienced fighters. Their major occupation was raiding islands and capturing slaves. The Moro warriors went up north to capture slaves in quick raids. The captives were traded to Chinese and European major buyers of the slaves. There were special techniques for capturing people. For instance, they do not let go of their weapon, and they grab you, knock you down, hold you and direct the blade to you, saying, "Surrender or die." Their methods of fighting were very fast. They could jump high into the air and strike down with their sword. And this jump was as high as your head, with a fast swing cutting you down, then moving from side to side. Constant moves and jumps with a long kampilang sword.
Always very, very agile. Always running away. And they also cut the legs that way. So, a Spanish general was killed by two Moros. The first Moro jumped up and tried to hit him in the head. He covered himself with his shield and slashed the belly. Okay? Then another one came up because he had no helmet. He was able to cut him in the head and he died before he got to the ship. So they were always more respectful of the fighters in the south.
Grandmaster Mateo Di Stelioso, yes, he stands about 5 feet in our measurement. Well, I studied under him every day. We would start like he would teach me, do ekes or otso. We call it otso ekes, and that lesson would take me about 1 week, 2 weeks for the same stroke. And then he would say, oh, you're looking good now. Okay, this is another one. He would put another one, say, you strike it from the mountain to the sea. I said, oh, what mountain is, where's the mountain? Oh, mountain is here. So I strike it from here. So now you call it banda, side to the side.
Banda.
Yes, and back. So banda, y banda. Eh?
So on, until every day I trained him, rain or shine, I would remember maybe about straight 7, 8, or 9 years. Every day, yeah. Even I don't feel good, I would go there with my bike.
But once there was when he was getting old already, he gathered his special students and including me,
yes.
And he said to them, "I am getting old. Yes, somebody must take care of Abanico Tres Puntas.
Right.
I want all of you to take care of this, but somebody must be on top." So he said, listen, everybody, Rene, come here. And then he said, listen, everybody, I am leaving Abanico Tres Puntas to you. He said, oh, Grandmaster, I don't think I am the right one. He said, I did not say you're the right one. I am just saying that I am leaving it to you. I said, oh, okay. So take care of Abanico Tres Puntas. And that's the start of until today.
It's so interesting, you know, hearing about Apanicos Tres Puntas,
mm-hmm.
Hearing your history. It's definitely a pleasure. I feel like we're friends already, you know, the whole time.
Yes.
I feel the bond.
Yes, now, yes.
I wanted to ask you, have you heard anything about the King's Blade? Is this a legend? Is it real?
King's Blade.
King's Blade.
You see, a blade is like I said, is part of our tradition. It's part of our way of life. And once you have that blade, it's a precious, it's no longer a tool. It's a symbol of supremacy, and it's a symbol of your toughness because you're a king. So if I have a blade, I'm the king. The power not to suppress people, but the power to protect people, protect his family, and protect his kingdom. He needs his blade. And it comes from many, many years of tradition, many years of training, and the discipline is number one. Yes.
Yeah, Manico Tres Puntas knife system. It's a kit. It's a banda application. Some kit in the front. Banda. Then.
I would encourage you to still continue searching for it. It's just somewhere else.
Yes,
yes. It could be somewhere else. Maybe from here you can find another one and so on. But I would say the King's Blade is not only on the blade, it's in the heart.
I'm impressed by your mastery and your wisdom, Grandmaster Tongson, says Felix. I must think your words over and find the right way.
About 1800s, 1850s, too many noblemen in Europe were dying from duels, especially France. So the kings of Europe agreed to issue an edict, a law, prohibiting the carriage of swords by noblemen. Okay? Because at that time, it was the noblemen who carried swords so that they cannot fight in duels. They also issued a law where the winner of a duel was hung, so nobody wins. Okay. Because the Philippines was a territory of Spain. The law was taken around 1860. What was prohibited was gentlemen carrying swords, dress swords. So without dress swords, they resorted to wearing canes, bastard wood, and they learned to fight with the baston. So there was a transition from sword fighting to cane fighting.
If you want to learn more, Alex, go to Cebu Island, advises the Grandmaster Macapagal. There you will meet the legendary Nicomedes Elizar. He's one of the best caretakers of old Sikh fighting traditions, which were formed under the influence of European fencing.
GM Nick, it was not so easy to find you here.
You're looking for me?
Yes.
How do you know me?
Because you're a legend here.
Legend?
Yes.
Then what is your intention to me?
I would like to ask you some questions.
You would like to ask some questions?
Yes.
I think it's not good. But better, before I will answer you, this flipper. I know you are a stick fighter because you are looking for me. So, what do you think?
Of course, sir.
Pretty stick.
Oh. Let's play first.
So, we look for a place?
Yes.
For our training, right?
Yes.
I think this is the right place to play.
Yeah.
It's okay?
Looks good. Okay, Jim, let's stop. May I ask you my questions now?
What is that question?
I will ask you straight. Okay. Do you know something about King's Blade?
King's Blade? For me, King's Blade is only a legend. But I can answer you. But before I will give you the answer, I will first introduce to you to my close friend, Grandmaster Bobby Taboada.
Opo.
Okay? Okay, let's go.
On the way to Cebu City, Alex reflects on the story of the Grandmaster's friendship.
Yesterday.
From early childhood, they grew up together, trained together, shared food and hardships, sang and had fun together.
Suddenly, I'm not half the man I used to be. There's a shadow hanging over me. Oh, I believe in yesterday. Why say had to go, I don't know. She wouldn't say. I say something wrong now.
where both families look after the, as we are caretaker of the property of the owner of the University of the Visayas. Our parents is ordering us to clean up the yard and things like that, and the farms, and then we planted some cocoa or bananas and star apples, mangoes, and when we harvest it, we deliver it to the owner. So that's our job, just to stay on that place. That is our payment for this, to stay in that place. Their families and our families. We're good friends. What do you have? Can I have that? Always have. I have no money. He had money. Can you borrow me something? I have no money. His problem is my problem. My problem is not his problem. Then we don't have, we don't go forward. It's always problem. He had fight, I have fight. I have fight, he had fight.
Fight
no progression.
His fight is my fight.
So,
his trouble is my trouble.
Somebody told me, oh yeah, 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 we fight one day. I don't know what it is. Why we fight at that time?
Yeah, we're playing, you know?
Childish playing
then.
So we play, and then we end up fighting. We fight. Boom. And then I grab him like this, and he go like this to me, like that.
I grab him
in my throat like that. But then, and then he cannot hardly, you know, get out because I'm bigger. See, he comes. He called his the dog.
I brought him to my dog.
The dog called Lapu-Lapu.
Lapu-Lapu, Kalapu-Lapu.
Lapu-Lapu.
He showed
this dog coming back at the back. Take the dog out, take the dog out. Oh my God, I hate that dog, man. We do not go to their place to pass by because that's where we pass our going to something on the other side. We cannot pass in their place because of that dog, Lapu-Lapu. So that's a little story down there that we learn a lot, changing life. But it's good to remember all those bad days, and then we can teach them now what we're doing before. So some people will let them know what we are, and then this nowadays, these people, new students, new generations, how lucky they are, they live like now, you know. Not like we don't have any computer before. We don't have any telephone, you know, cell phone, we don't have that. And then I will show everybody that how lucky they are now. So we will tell our story, the bad part of it, the really bad part of it, so that they will learn.
Love was such an easy game to play.
So everybody, the only difference is I am the most handsome. They are all ugly.
And yesterday.
Alex is impressed by the two men, their wisdom, life experience, and dedication to their friendship. He decides to stay and explore secrets of the mastery under their guidance. For the first time in 40 years, Grandmasters Nicomedes Elizar and Bobby Taboada cross their training sticks like in olden days. The unique essence of Balintawak style lies in the non-standard use of stick fighting techniques at close range. The history of Balintawak goes back to the turbulent times of the Spanish colonization of the Philippines. At that time, fate brought together two men in a little cell of the town jail. One of those men was a French sailor who had deserted his ship, and the other was a man called Saavedra, a rebel fighting against Spanish colonization. Both were skilled in fencing and knew how to use blades. In the dead of night, when everyone was asleep, they would improvise duels using twigs and slivers for weapons. That was the beginning of the art, based on technique of using long and short blades and short European sword. Later, the founder of Balintawak would train under Saavedra in his fencing school and would transfer and incorporate many techniques to his stick fighting style. I'm sure the King's Blade is not a myth. It must exist. I know Grandmaster Rene put me on the right track. Only through hard training, iron discipline, and reaching my full potential will the path to the blade be revealed. I see my goal and I shall not go astray. There's no fatigue. There's no pain. Only the victory. The path Felix has chosen didn't fill him with energy and faith in his forthcoming success. It is an early summer morning in the suburbs of Cebu. After many long days of training, the time has come for Alex to test his new skills and to hear parting words from Grandmaster Bobby Taboada.
I was introduced to Balintawak to, one of my friends said, "This is Balintawak." And then, actually, I really love it when they showed me a little bit of those demonstrations. Like they're using a pin, just a pin. And I always told everybody about this, even my interviews. Like I like the way they showed me, just a little pin, writing pin. And actually that was Bobby Tabimina, Grandmaster Bobby Tabimina and Grandmaster Tuviles. I really like that because it's like a short distance. I like it because it's just like boxing, short distance. So I was hooked to that, so I started practicing them like that. So that's where I started Balintawak. When I started it, basic, for a long, long time, okay? They always teach you like the 12 basic strikes, always in control. They don't show anything more than that. The most important is the control. Then they always watch out your attitude, your character, right? They will ask you, and they will always looking for that because that's the main thing for them. Like myself, I am very show off. I like karate, I like boxing, showing my kicks and things like that, you know. I like high kicks and things like that, but Grandmaster doesn't like that, you know, if you're showing off. That's why it took me a long time to learn for the next level, like the grouping system, hitting me anywhere he wants, giving me bloods all the time, every practice. Even somebody is watching there in our school just to demonstrate a little bit for the student, new student, he's always hitting. That's the difference before, right? Accept the pain, right? Because if you lose, you focus for that one pain only, then you lose. Because it's very painful, boom, and then you panic. So accept that pain, just one time, only one pain.
For the first time while mastering this unique art, Alex forgets what he's initially here for. He had become so engrossed with the Balintawak style, he felt, King's Blade, it's in my hands already. That same evening, Felix is strolling along the streets of Cebu, wishing to meet local grandmasters. He doesn't know yet that fortune turned away from him that day. The courageous traveler is just a little too late. The people he needs have already left the city. Our dreamers cross paths for the first time in the old Spanish San Pedro fortress. Both of them sense that it is not a random meeting. This guy here's not by chance, thinks Felix. He's probably looking for the same thing, utters Alex to himself. Well, let's see which of us will be the first. Alex doesn't lose time. He takes a night bus from Cebu and arrives early in the morning in Bacolod City. The city has another name, the City of Smiles. There were times when its inhabitants nearly starved and took to wearing smiling masks to cheer each other up and to conceal their sufferings. In the outskirts of the city, Alex tries to find information about Master Noi, who used to live there. It's a poor area where life hasn't changed much since these smiling times. The locals tell him that Noi has a different life now. Martial arts have paved the road to new opportunities for him. Alex can hardly imagine what sort of ordeal will bring him to the master. Foreigners are hardly welcome in this district, and asking too many questions might cause serious troubles. Choice but to fight, thinks Alex. Stop! Drop your blades, someone shouts. Alex's pursuers see the wrathful faces of Master Nanoi and Ramel, the well-known fighters of Macalad. It is better not to mess with them. Even a stick is lethal in their hands. He has been saved by the very people he was searching for. Not only do they save him from great danger, but they agree to accept him as their student.
In a traditional way, in the absence of any equipment, traditional method on how you condition physically, or the physical training conditioning, must be empty-handed. So we will be using our physical structure for conditioning. Let's say for making the finger strong, for gripping, because we usually carry weapons, so we must have to have a strong grip. From the island of Negros, Philippines, and my birthplace is from Bacolod City. I'd been into Filipino martial art when I was at a very young age. So I learned a lot from different grandmaster who happens to be my relatives and close family friends. This make the finger strong for grabbing purposes, for gripping. So you have to stand still, stand very strong, and then that's it. This is good for fingers. Make your finger strong and then try to reverse it this way. This way you develop the strength on the strike of your palm, of your hand. So this makes you very strong. This makes your hand fast. Now to make it stiff, to make it strong, we have the banging of the arm. So we used to train like this. So it maintains good positioning, good balance. Also for the power training, and resistance training. Traditionally, Filipino fighting art is most likely to be combat-oriented or weapon arts. So we, all the time, or most of the time, we use weapons. We use close-quarter combat, actual fighting, no fancy moves. You get out, you cut the arm. The same we use with the small weapon, or the shorter weapon, which is the knife. If he attacks you on the neck, the same principle, you get out. You deflect, you cut, you get out, and then you control. So there is no block, there is no stance. Always right positioning and right angles of attack. The same principle here, always get out. Be safe. Your position must be safe enough. Protect your body. The same principles we use with the empty hands. If the guy try to punch you, the same, get out. So meaning you don't catch the hand, no catching, just deflect, get out, and hit. So get deflect, get out, and hit. So whatever we use with a long weapon, short weapon, and no weapon at all, the same principle. Because we had been into different wars in the Philippines. So our forefathers, they inculcate in our mind that this is for wars. This is not for tournament. This is for real fight. So they have to prepare us for another war coming if there is. That's why they train us in reality and a no-nonsense technique. When we were being trained during my younger days together with some others, especially with my sparring partner, Romel Tortal, during our younger days, our grandmaster doesn't want us to use fake weapons, meaning we use live weapons, live blade like this. No fake weapons, because it is not available on the market. We have no resources after all. Of course, we have cuts, we have bruises, but we always use our traditional method. We have special herbs, we have special oil for the wounds, so it can easily heal. But in the Philippines, nobody stopped our weapon culture. Meaning, from this Ribijayan Empire to Majapahit Empire until the Spanish time, the American time, and the Japanese era, everyone here carries weapon all the time. Nobody stopped that. It is part of our culture. It is part of our custom. So it is customary to a household to have a bladed weapon or a bolo in his house. It is being used for daily practice, for daily needs, and it is being used for spiritual needs and, of course, for combat purposes. Ready for war. If you are being trained in Filipino martial arts, you can always use something into a weapon. Even if it is not bladed weapon, it will be a very dangerous weapon in the hands of an expert. So Filipino martial art is being practiced in Negros Occidental from a lot of styles and systems. So I was able to learn few of them. And now I travel the world. I am a researcher. I am an adventurer. And I am a collector. I collect artifacts from around the world, especially weapon, bladed weapon.
It is getting dark, and the time has come for the most important question.
Tuhon Nanoy, your art, your martial art is very impressive, and I really loved it. But I have only one question for you. Can you help me to find the king's blade?
The king's blade? Because you are very diligent in practicing our culture and our art, I will tell you the truth. You can only find the king's blade in the island of Negros. You must go there, make your research, learn different styles, and you can find the king's blade in the island of Negros.
Alex receives an unexpected telephone call, and as a result, he once again encounters Grandmaster Romeo Macapagal.
Well, it's a bit of a longer story, but I will say it anyway. Yes. I started when I was only maybe 8 or 9 years old. From my grandfather, I had to stand on a stool, on a chair, for him to teach me. Okay. Now, what he taught me until maybe I was 12, when he started to get weak already, was enough to give me a sense of Arnis. Or in the case of my tribe, the Kapampangan, we call it estocada. Okay, from the Spanish word to thrust. Okay, meaning to say using of the rapier. Later on, I felt I needed some exercise. I thought of going to Luneta, and I saw Tatang, and I saw a movement from Tatang that reminded me of the movements from my grandfather. Since I thought that I did not get enough from my grandfather, I went up to Tatang and asked him, "Sir, can you please accept me as a student? Can you give me instruction?" He took a look at me and then he said, "Okay, I will teach you." And that started a long and intimate friendship of one of the greatest men I ever knew. But this was a unique character. Very keen mind, very observant, very practical, and very kind. Now, the history of Tatang Ilustrisimo goes back to his birth in Bantayan Island. He belonged to a family of escrimadores, Arnis people.
Grandmaster Macapagal can't resist the temptation of demonstrating to Alex the legacy of his teacher, Tuhon Ilustrissimo. All of the life and combat experience of Tuhon Ilustrissimo was reflected in his fighting system. He started traveling in his early years, and his journey were full of danger and adventures. Wherever he happened to find himself, he encountered different people. Some challenged him and tested his combat skills. Taking into consideration the fact that Tuhon Ilustrissimo had never been wounded in those many little skirmishes, we can easily imagine what happened to his opponents. He never turned down a job, even if it was dangerous or even of criminal character. His fate brought him to rich people, counterfeiters, bounty hunters, and even those who arranged underground fights. He retired at the age of 80, even though he was still strong and sound-minded. He had always thought that his fighting skills were for his personal use, but still, he started training a group of enthusiasts who take care of his legacy to this day.
Melesio Ilustrissimo was the most famous, and in Melesio's technique, there are still the strong influence of Silat, because it is an older system from that of Tatang. It was still used in fighting the Spaniards. It was influenced by the Spaniards, and then later on in the fight for independence, the Filipino used it against the Spaniard. Okay. There are stories of Melesio. And then he had a practice of people throwing spears at him. Okay, and he just get the spear and put it down by his side, like firewood. Okay. He had a system of fighting, and we still have that. When there are many opponents, to lie on the ground and fight.
Lying down.
Because if you don't have a wall, you have the ground. And on the ground you can spin. On the wall you cannot spin. So it is also a very effective system. He could disarm with his feet. And we also have that method to disarm with the feet and to cut at the legs of the people around.
Sayaw is a ritual combat dance of Filipino tribes from the north to the south. It is an element of warrior culture, and the tradition is still alive to this day. Its objective is to raise fighting spirit, to banish forces of evil, to attract fortune, and to practice combat techniques through shadow fighting to prepare for battle with real enemies. Felix senses the possibility of an imminent fight, and so he resorts to this ancient ritual.
He also had this footwork. People claim it is not true, but Tatang says it is true. He drove a nail, big nail, through his foot into the floor, and then pulled out the nail and allowed the wound to keep open, so that later on when he practiced, he would get the nail, put it through his foot, put it through the hole, and then he would move around in a circle around it. And that is called walong apak, 8 steps. With Tatang, the training method was just like in the old days. Meaning to say, no armor, using sticks, hardwood or rattan, live rattan sticks. And it was a painful process because our sparring was mainly to hit the hand or hit the forearm. We used to have lost fingernails every other week because it would be hit, turn black, and then it will drop. We could take it because we were an older generation used to pain.
A quest for knowledge is at times difficult and dangerous. It can be yet another country, another city, or another island. It doesn't matter. Having found no trace of the king's blade on the Isle of Negros, Alex arrives at Palawan, where he is to meet with Master Romeo Tortal on one of the deserted beaches.
Today, we will start training. I'm gonna teach you
proper foundation and the strong foundation of the system. The most important things in Filipino fighting art is a footwork strategy. We will start training, okay, using the different footworks in a traditional manner as far as a Filipino fighting art in under the principle of Piki Tertia. In Filipino fighting art, it's not only a weaponry, it's not only the sticks, it's not only the blade, it's the effectivity of the hand, because the hand is the expression. It is an expression that coming from the blade. Filipino fighting art, based on our, as far as our empty hand is concerned, is what we call pangamot, dumog pangamot. It's a very dirty application, very dirty technique, very dirty, when you manipulate, when you apply, very destructive. Lots of breakings, legs destruction. If you apply it, make sure the opponent or the attacker is good in 3 seconds. Once you attack, finish him. Don't give him a chance. In a real Filipino martial arts practitioners, it's not about the skills. Skills, eventually, you will improve if you have a good heart. If you are humble, if you have a good heart, you are a better person towards other people, absolutely, you improve your skills, because the teacher will upload to you and teach you in a proper way, in a skills for you to improve. So it's not about the skills, it's about the behavior.
Finally, a moment comes when Alex risks asking Master Romel about the king's blade.
No matter what, wherever you travel, wherever you are, okay? Whether you find a king's blade or not, most important, being a practitioner, your direction and your focus towards training. Because king's blade is not the real blade. It's in your heart, as it's in your mind. King's blade is the level of your understanding and the wisdom and the purity of heart of how you receive the training coming from your teacher.
Wise thoughts of the young master remind Alex of the parting words of one of his mentors, Grandmaster Romeo Macapagal.
GM Rene Tongson and I are some of the last searchers for that lost blade, the lost skill with the sword, which is why we devote ourselves to a classical sword system. In his case, Abanico Tres Puntas. In my case, the Illustrissimo system. Because it is not the weapon, it is the man. It is not the sword, it is the man. And you can handle anything or even nothing at all and still be able to defend yourself, defend others, stop evil, because you know your body, you know your mind, you know the principles on how to fight and use a sword, because you have found the king's blade, the king's way of handling the blade, of commanding the blade. Thank you.
Master Nonoy has secluded himself far in the mountains, located in the impenetrable jungle of one of the islands, where he had once found a source for his knowledge and combat skills. Our dreamers are ready to overcome any obstacle impending their quest. Persisting through the challenges of their rough terrain, Felix finds Master Nonoy. Being not only a kind but also a fun-loving man, Master Nonoy decides to give Felix a special test. You move not so badly in cold water, thinks Master Nonoi. Now, I shall call you not just Felix, but Iron Felix.
I've been looking for you because I heard that you can help me to find the King's Blade.
The King's Blade again. King's Blade, nowhere to be found here. Doesn't exist. It's actually a legend.
Well, I've heard that is many stories that it's a legend, but also many stories that it's not a legend.
I'm grateful for the lesson you have given me, says Felix, parting ways with Master Nonoi.
It's not a legend at all. It exists, and I am the only one who can find it.
In the Philippines, cockfighting is a national sport. Its traditions go back to the 16th century when the Spanish first arrived. It had quickly become popular with the indigenous population and is now a part of Filipino culture. Alex and Felix are venturous and risk-loving guys. They can't pass by real fighting with razor-sharp spurs. Stakes are made before each fight. You can gamble away all your money to a nickel, or if you're not good at sign language, you can get yourself in a life-threatening situation.
Amigo, here's your money. Mm. Maybe next time, you're not so lucky.
Yeah, maybe.
But I think it's not all money.
That's what we agreed on.
It's only half. You must give me more.
Maybe I think this is not about money.
Maybe.
Maybe it's about something else.
Yes.
Yeah. But you don't want the money. Give me the money.
Okay. Just get it.
Okay. That's the way you want it. Okay.
Breaking law and order in the Philippines is not such a good idea. The local police are effective, as well as professional. Once the matter is settled and after a good laugh, the police let the troublemakers go and advise them not to get into any more fights over trivial matters. This is just money. Good relationships are more important. It is said that if a task is too difficult for one person, you should unite your efforts and try to reach your goal together. Felix and Alex decide to meet again on the mysterious island where Grandmaster Rodel lived. They start a new search as a team, as the beginning of their friendship and close union as brothers in martial arts. Grandmaster Rodel had anticipated their meeting and had been waiting for them for a long time.
Welcome to my island. I'm waiting for you.
Yes, actually, I started the training with the Filipino martial art.
One.
Especially Arnis.
Two.
We do some stick
three,
fighting. And also,
four,
aside from stick, we
five,
use also deadly weapon. Like, we call it buru here in the Philippines, or knives. And then we train also double stick, and of course, empty hand. Because I believe that Arnis is one of the very effective martial art ever. I started learning this as what I've seen that I've learned from both uncle, but during that time, there is no system. We call it, in Iloilo, we call it backyard system. When the instructor will ask you, you want to learn, okay. Then the instructor will tell you, okay, you strike this way, then the instructor will hit you. But not too many people wants to learn because the instructor really hit you, so it's a little bit scared, you know. That's why Arnis will be becoming dying art because of that. After I finished from my uncle, I went to Manila. After I graduated from my technical course, I tried to look the Grandmaster, Grandmaster Rene Amador Pisas, who was the founder of modern Arnis. I stayed in their family just to learn Arnis. But during that time, I'm also interested more karate comparing to Arnis. But later on, because he was the founder of modern Arnis, he pushed me, you train this, do this, do this. Then I got interest later on. So as what I've seen that in my system, I try to develop, you know, I try to create classical like that, disarming, locking, takedown, because I believe that I don't really do a lot of fancy things like that. So meaning you try to concentrate hitting your opponent in one time. Now, without any fancy things, twirling for nothing. So that's why I develop good classical, because that you can really use for real fighting. To be a good teacher, okay, you have to know, as what I've said, that you know all the cardinal rules. Of course, you have to try to explain to your student, by not only, if you want to learn, just strike this, strike there, no. You have to explain first about discipline, like loyalty to the art, of course, respect your instructor.
All right,
yeah, just to produce a good student. So what I mean is, you try to, when you start training with the from the kids, you try to already to explain about, you train this not for aggression. That's in simple way, you know. You learn this not for aggression, but adequate for self-protection.
Okay, GM, but what is the story about this kinglet? Why it's so powerful and why it's so important in the Philippines?
Assuming this is a blade, I'm the king of my blade. Barak! Beast! Bam! Because for me, if you have blades in your hand, because it's easy to fight with the use of blade, you know, very effective weapon. That's why I can fight many opponents, you know. Because blade is very effective weapon for me. I can defend, I can offense and defense against opponents. It's very important to have light of fight by using the blade. That's why, as what I've said, that if you have blades, you are like a king.
No, compadre, you may not have found the king's blade, but I think we found something more important. We found friendship, and we found a new set of skills. And maybe in the future, we'll have another quest for the king's blade.
You can count on me anytime, amigo.
Salud.
The way that leads you to your goal is sometimes much more important than the goal itself. As for the road, everyone has their own roads.
the King's Blade? It's not a legend at all. It exists. It's true. You can find it there in the island of Negros.